Hello, everybody. Welcome to the UW Robotics Colloquium. I'm super excited to start this quarter's series with today's speaker, Katerina Fragkiadaki. Katerina is faculty in the machine learning department at Carnegie Mellon University. She got her PhD working with Jumbo Shi at UPenn, and then did a postdoc in Jitendra Malik's group at UC Berkeley. And broadly, Katerina is working on learning visual representations of the world. And I believe that learning representations is one of the biggest and most important open problems in robotics. And of course, the vision and machine learning communities have made a lot of progress in these directions, but typically coming from a robotics perspective, some of these works are kind of, from our perspective, kind of too constrained. They are dealing just with individual images. They are kind of supporting, let's say, what we roboticists might call 2D image reasoning, but not really reasoning about the 3D world. Then often again, they are dealing just with individual images. But despite that, there's been great progress on learning representations in weakly supervised ways, also in the language community. And Katerina's background is coming from vision and machine learning, but I'm super excited to see that she actually approaches the problem very much coming from a perspective that these representations need to support 3D reasoning about the world, where it's not only about individual images, but really understanding the 3D structure of the world and how, for example, an agent or robot can interact with these objects and learning these representations from weakly supervised data. So I think this direction is something that will become just more and more important also in robotics. And I'm looking forward to seeing what she's going to tell us today about her recent work in that area. So thanks very much, Katerina.
Thank you very much for your introduction. Thank you for your invitation. That was a fantastic introduction to the theme of the talk, which is learning 3D scene representations for vision and for interaction. So as Dieter said, we're very good at understanding 2D images, and not any 2D images, 2D images with specific photographic biases. The reason is that our computer vision models are trained from data sets, annotated data sets that themselves can be collected from images that people take and upload on the web. So they're photographs. There is a very intelligent agent, the human photographer, that has already solved computer vision, centered the image, fixed the scale, and took the picture. Once you see videos in the wild, and to be honest, this is also taken by a semi-intelligent agent. So it still doesn't look as garbage as what a robot would collect. And the question is, how do we approach computer vision from this type of input? Despite the fact that the camera moves, all of us can develop a stable model of the scene behind the video. And the problem is that CNNs, convolutional neural networks, that do frame by frame processing, have difficulty handling videos taken by a moving camera. There is no object permanence. Objects appear and disappear at occlusions. They move with the camera motion. They change size with the camera zoom in and zoom out. And overall, in the 2D image and in the resulting 2D CNN features, the camera motion is entangled with the scene appearance. And that's what makes the problem a challenge. Now, this is a robotics audience, and we all love simultaneous localization and mapping, a very, very well-researched topic. And what does simultaneous localization mapping do? It takes as input a video and separates the camera motion from the scene appearance and captures scene appearance into a point cloud map of the scene. And indeed, SLAM does have object permanence. This teddy bear here was not there in every image, but is there at the map of the scene. But what is the problem with SLAM? The problem with SLAM is that despite the nice object permanence that shows, is that it doesn't do a modal completion. So here I'm showing you a desktop, an office scene. Next time that I'll show up in an office, again, I need to move around the office scene from different viewpoints to capture the map. I cannot learn to predict what the camera does not see, what we also call a model completion. All right, so humans can do a model completion, but the machines still are not great at this task. And there has been an excellent research on combining deep learning with 3D representations. And here I'm showing some of notable works that I also love. These works, though, focus very much on extracting very accurate 3D occupancies or in generating beautiful photorealistic images, just like NERF, the NERF works I'm showing here. The inputs are usually a single object in the scene. There is no clutter. So we don't do 3D for the sake of object detection, segmentation, visual recognition. Rather, we do 3D for the sake of 3D and for the sake of graphics. Okay. Now, as Rodney Brooks had put it as early as in 1991, the computer vision community was very much focused on extracting 3D reconstructions from images and videos. So Rodney said that internal world models, which are complete representations of the external environment, besides being impossible, they may not be necessary for agents to act in the competent manner. And developing agents that act intelligently, we can say, is the end goal of artificial intelligence. Now, having said that, the Roomba robot does construct a 2D map of the scene, right? And actually, it is extremely useful. But let's see how we can combine these two perspectives. One is we don't want to do 3D for the sake of 3D, but we want to develop representations trained end-to-end for the final task. So in this talk, we'll discuss about 3D feature representations. Essentially, these are just feature maps, very similar to the 2D feature maps of CNNs, but instead of being width by height by number of channels, here we have width by height by depth by number of channels, so we have one more dimension. These feature maps are wolf-centric, they are not image-centric, and we'll see how we can extract those from images and videos under weak supervision and how we can train them for the end tasks that we care about. And specifically, we'll talk about visual tracking, detecting objects in 3D, predicting their occupancy, learning dynamics models, learning policies for manipulation of objects, and language grounding. So if at any point on the talk you have a question, please just unmute yourselves and ask. So I'll start by discussing our architectures that we proposed in 2019. We call them geometry-aware recurrent networks. These are networks that take as input 2D images and videos, and they spit out those three-dimensional feature maps. They have two main innovations with respect to previous models, for example, recurrent networks. The first is that the latent state has three special dimensions, width, height, and depth, despite the fact that the image, the input is still two-dimensional or 2.5D dimensional. And the third is that, similar to SLAM, the latent state updates how this feature map is updated. It takes into account ego motion. And let me show you exactly what I mean. So here is a small video sequence that captures a coffee machine from different viewpoints. So far, we're going to discuss about static scenes. Nothing is moving in the scene, only the camera is moving. So what happens is that every frame, and if you have also a depth map, also the depth of the frame, is unprojected into a 3D feature map using the intrinsics of the camera that we assume known. And then they're combined and passed through some 3D convolutional layers, and they're combined into this 3D feature map from frame to frame. And the important thing is that as the next frame comes, we estimate the ego motion through a 3D rotation and translation from frame 1 to 2, and we transform the features. This is a differentiable operation that doesn't use any parameters. It just transforms the features, it rotates and translates before it adds them in the map. This is very similar to SLAM. It's as if we have a neural network that does a SLAM in its heart. And in this way, we accumulate information from different frames. Now, as a result of this ego stabilization operation, this transformation of the features using the camera motion, you may take here a point on the handle of the coffee machine that because the camera moves, it changes pixel XY location from frame to frame. But after this ego stabilization, it lands on the same location on the 3D feature map. So we manage to obtain a stable model of the world, despite the fact that the camera is moving. And this is not surprising. We did something very similar to SLAM. So naturally, we're going to have a stable map. Now, the interesting thing is that the first thing we need to note is that if you do just 2D convolutions, if you just do 2D convolutions, which nobody does anymore because everybody uses transformers. So transformers is much, much better idea for video processing because transformers explicitly searches from correspondences over time. But if you just do some convolutional STM or convolutional GRU and so on, that people do, what you get is that your hidden state essentially is corrupted by how the camera is moving. Because convolutions cannot actually undo camera motion. So here the point on the handle of the coffee machine is going to be in different places in the 2D feature maps and in different places in the hidden state of the memory. Okay, so each time you change the camera motion, your hidden state is going to change dramatically. So this is not what happens with the GRNNs. We call them geometry aware recurrent networks. We will also call it GRNN. But how is this different than SLAM? Well, the interesting thing is that you can train those networks without human annotations, just by trying to predict how different views of the scene look like. So here's a query viewpoint. And because you are an embodied agent, you can go to that query viewpoint and see what the camera sees. And now you can ask your network to predict this image from that viewpoint. And you can propagate the error because everything is end-to-end differentiable. So what did you manage to do? If you train for view prediction, this network here learns to complete the input images with other views that it hasn't seen. So this 3D feature map manages to do amodal completion of the scene that you're looking at. And so we visualized what the network was learning. I want to point out that we are not the first to train networks for view prediction. There are many papers that use this objective for training visual representations. Here is one, neural scene representations and rendering from DeepMind, DQN. The difference is that our network goes through this explicit 3D feature bottleneck. While previous networks, they either squeeze everything into 1D embedding or 2D feature maps and so on. So what do you get out of this explicit three-dimensional spatial bottleneck? Is that you can train your network on scenes with two objects and then ask it to predict views from scenes with more objects and see if it manages to generalize. And what you see is that our network, without ever training on multi-object scenes, reasonably predicts views from multiple objects, while GQN and other networks that don't have 3D bottlenecks still see only two objects. So you don't have reasonable generalization, okay? An excellent question from Adam. What happens if ego motion is noisy? We have tried with noisy go motion. If the error is small, it is okay. If the error is large, the memory is going to get corrupted. All right. So it is sensitive to how good is the ego motion we can estimate. Now, the truth is that if you are an active agent, you don't need to use every frame. You just select when you're confident. First of all, you select how you move in the scene. So you have a knowledge of your approximate ego motion, but also you can also select the frames. You can make yourself move in a way that your ego motion is actually accurately estimated. But yes, we do hope that ego motion estimation works reasonably well. So this is what happens. So we just discussed about view prediction. Now, the truth is that predicting photorealistic images, first of all, it's hard. And second of all, it may be unnecessary. So instead of predicting image pixels, we change the objective and we say, why don't we predict feature maps instead? So basically when you render your 3D feature, when you project it, instead of trying to spit out pixels and minimize pixel, Euclidean pixel error, you predict 2D feature map. And here's the query viewpoint. You have another concurrently trained CNN. So nothing is pre-trained, it's also concurrently trained. And then you match them and you minimize the contrastive loss. Now, contrastive losses now are extremely, extremely popular. Here we do a pixel-wise contrastive loss, which means that corresponding pixels need to have the higher inner products than non-corresponding pixels. And you can do this in 2D space, or you can do it in a 3D space, right here, without going projecting in 2D, state in 3D and do a 3D contrastive loss. It looks something like that. You have your two views and...
I have a question.
Yes, please.
So how do you prevent the network from outputting like a constant output? Because that is like perfectly consistent.
Yeah, exactly. So contrastive losses, they tell you the following thing. They tell you, make sure the feature map here, the feature vectors of corresponding pixels, the positive correspondence, is higher than inner product between non-corresponding pixels. Mm-hmm. So this contrastive loss does not allow you to collapse.
Yeah.
Okay?
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. So what happens? You can train this from scratch, and you can visualize now what you got. And how do you visualize it? Because it's a 3D feature map, and each grid point has a long vector, right, that captures geometric and semantic properties of that physical point of the scene, for example, my shoulder. So we slice it, we go bird view, and we slice it, and we take the feature vectors and we do PCA, and this is what I'm showing here, the colors that you obtain with the first three principal components. And you see that the features follow the cars. And indeed, we use those representations to track objects in the scene, and they do reasonably well, trained from scratch, without ever trained for correspondence over time, because they're trained from static scenes. They can also correspond things over time without trained for such ground truth. Now, what else can you do with those 3D feature maps?
Katerina?
Yes, yes.
Related question to Asana's previous one. So you're training jointly, kind of doing the ego motion estimation and the contrastive loss. Is this stable? Because you have to bootstrap somehow, I would assume, right?
A great question. No, we don't. The ego motion module is the only thing that is not trained end to end. It's assumed given. It's assumed that you know your ego motion. Okay. And the other thing that we found is that if you try to share the features, you don't do well. For estimating the ego motion, you may need different features than for view prediction. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that's the other thing we found. So you first train your ego motion module to, you know, estimate ego motion, or you use some state-of-the-art technique that is there already, and then you plug it in and assume ego motion known, and then you train your view predictor.
And just one more question. So you trained on static images and then you tested on the dynamic scenes with moving objects, right?
Yeah. And the way we do it is every frame is unprojected independently. So from mm-hmm. every frame, you try to imagine the full scene, okay?
And wouldn't it break because it's kind of like has this like inconsistency across different views because the objects are moving around, then how does the LSTM basically resolve those inconsistent information?
Okay, yeah, so I didn't explain it correctly. Let me explain. So here, for every, so forget about the LSTM. So now we unproject every image into a 3D feature map. And then what we do is we initialize the bounding box, the 3D bounding box of an object. And then we take feature vectors inside the object and we try to compute where these feature vectors go in the next frame. And then we do some ransack estimation, and then we say, oh, this is the 3D rotation and translation of the car. Mm-hmm. And the reason we do that is to show that, look, by doing this contrastive view prediction, you learn features useful for visual correspondence, which is what you care about. The only thing we care about is visual correspondence, correspondability.
Thanks.
Now, what else can you do with the 3D feature map? So we were very optimistic and we said, here's what we're going to do. Everybody first segment objects and then unprojects and try to infer their 3D. We're going to do the opposite. First, we're going to make the 3D feature map and then we're going to segment it and so on. And indeed, in the 3D space, okay, it is easier to segment. I mean, it's not surprising. That's why also PointNet and all these segmentation methods that operate on 3D can segment objects better, because objects are naturally far away from one another. There is empty space and so on. Now here you take your frames, you make your 3D feature map, and you can train it supervised to predict 3D bounding boxes. Okay. And so now we have this self-supervised objective of view prediction and supervised objective of 3D object detection. And you can see that, I mean, one big question that we had for a long time is it important to generate images? Are photorealistic images important? Is, you know, generative models of images important for training good representations? And what we found here is that if you predict images, they represent the detection qualities, the accuracy of your detector drops in comparison to when you do this contrastive prediction. So contrastive prediction, you give up on looking at beautiful views, you learn better features for detection. And what I'm showing here is essentially you vary the amount of label data. And here is the mean average precision, how good is your detector. And you see that you have three curves. One is trained from scratch, one is pre-trained with predicting image views, and the other is predicting with feature, contrasted feature views. And you see that with smaller amount of label data, you have higher mean AP in this case. Now, a big downside of 3D feature maps is the resolution. The resolution, you are limited by the resolution of the grid. So what we did, and this is work that is going to show up in CPR in June, is we combined our representations with implicit functions. What is an implicit function? Well, instead of just having one feature vector at every grid location, now you can ask me any point in the space, and I'm going to query my representation by adding this function, this trainable function that has parameters theta f that I train. And how do I train this function? I take the feature vector of the nearby voxel where, let's say, the point falls in. Actually, I take all the eight corners, and then I take the offsets, and then I train this function to predict the corresponding feature vector and render and backpropagate and so on. And basically, the idea is that this trainable way of computing features are at subvoxel locations is better than just doing trilinear interpolation. So trilinear interpolation is the baseline. Here we show that you can have these functions, and then you can have higher quality features. Now, most previous papers, when they talk about implicit functions, is you have one implicit function for the whole object, right? So you collapse the spatial information. You just have one function, you query it with different locations of the object, and that function gives you occupancy 0, 1. Here we have two differences. You don't collapse, you still have your grid structure. Is that it's just alongside the 3D grid structure, you can go into continuous infinite spatial resolution. And you don't just predict the occupancy 0, 1 of the scene, that in any case you do. You predict the occupancy of your scene, but you also predict these features that you train with a contrastive view prediction that we set. So other than that, there is no difference. However, the results made a big difference. For example, here we show how this method does much better than our previous baseline, and also better than 3D point contrast, which is a very nice and strong baseline that just looks at point clouds and triangulates and learns features by triangulation. It does not try to do any model prediction, any completion. It just looks at whatever points are visible from two views and says, make sure you put those features close. Again, contrastive loss, but it's only whatever is visible from two views. And this is the dense object nets that learn features from 2D images as opposed to 3D point clouds. And as you see, learning in the 3D space where you use the camera intrinsics, the representations are more, correspondable, discriminative. And here again, we use it as a pre-training for VoteNet, and it gives a big boost as opposed to training from scratch, which is not surprising. Aside of that, I mean, probably you've seen already these nice images. Now you don't have any discretization artifacts. When you predict occupancy of objects, you have this nice smooth, meshes. You can also predict the RGB image if you want for debugging purposes. Here are some videos. And this is the first part of the talk that talks about how we'll train those feature representations by predicting views. Now, next, I want to discuss about
a quick question.
Yes, please.
So what happens, I mean, there are going to be scenarios where you have lots of homogeneous regions, which may confuse your correspondence network.
Yeah.
So does it learn some sort of semantics in some way? Because obviously now you have a much richer neighborhood if you use, say, transformers or whichever method. You can learn a lot more about, say, this is a wall. So in standard optical flow, you'll get confused there because they have a lot of uniform regions and it'll go garbage.
Yeah.
Do you observe this to be better at discriminating at semantics level as well?
No, it's also susceptible to this problem of walls. Absolutely, yeah. In fact, the right way to do this contrastive view is instead of every point, try to discriminate every point, you should take your corners and put there your features on corners that actually can be discriminated, or make bigger parts as opposed to single point, make bigger 3D parts and do such a discriminative learning in different levels of abstraction. Why only points, right? Why should I do it only on points? Yeah, so this is absolutely not a good final answer. Yeah. Okay, so the next thing we'll discuss is about predicting object interactions. And in 2016, we had a paper on billiard prediction. And here is an ICLR 2021 paper again on billiards, predicting balls or how do you move in a billiard table. And the general recipe of all those learning intuitive physics type of works is that you take the image that you assume it's a planar scene, you detect the objects, you compute features inside the object detections, and these are your nodes in your 2D graph network, and then you do some form of graph convolutions or message passing and so on, and you predict for every node the future motion and the future motion trajectory. And this is what I'm showing here, the predictions of this particular work, which is the most recent work in that regime. Now, what is the problem of all those methods that we've been trying to handle for a long time now? The problem is that they assume that the world is planar. They assume that everything operates in a 2D space. And the prediction you're going to learn from one viewpoint will not generalize to another viewpoint. So having described to you our GRNN machinery, then you know exactly what to do here. We like object permanence. We like the fact that when things get occluded in a 3D space, they're still going to be there somehow, right? Because in 3D, things do not interfere with one another. Everybody has its own space. We know that objects do not interpenetrate. They can go inside one another, but this means that one is hollow, and that's why the other stays there. So somehow, it's very intuitive to think about them. So what are we going to do? We're going to take our 2D image or 2.5D image and feed it into our machinery and get a 3D feature map of the scene. That the whole goal is that it's going to be a model completed, right? It's going to see also behind the objects. Then we'll detect our object with our 3D object detectors that we described, instantiate the graph network, very much like previous works, but this graph network also lives in a 3D space. And from that graph network, we're going to also feed the action, like which direction, the magnitude, and which object is operating on, and predict the 3D rotation and translation of the objects. And again, feed it as input to our graph network and so on and so forth, and roll forward and predict where the objects are going to go. So despite the fact that the network sees 2D in its input, it imagines in 3D, right? So the bottleneck, the neural bottleneck, is this 3D feature map that I'm trying to visualize here. As a result, no matter which viewpoint to pick to look at the particular scene, you get the same predictions, okay? You can put any viewpoint you like because any viewpoint will unproject to a very similar 3D feature map. So here you saw how the structure is going to fall once you let things drop. So our experiments concern scenes with multiple objects where we push the objects and we drop them and we see the results and we try to predict those trajectories. Yeah, so you can train again on two objects and generalize on three and four and five objects. And what we found is the following, that 2D networks that use 2D images and segment objects and feed them in the graph network to predict their future motions do equally well if you only train and test on the same viewpoint, but do not generalize as well if you use multiple viewpoints at training time, which this method easily handles, let's say. Okay. Okay. So now you can use your learned dynamics to push objects around in the simulation and in the real world, in the real robot setup. So the next thing that we try to look into is how can we use those 3D representations for policies, for picking up objects, putting them in specific locations, pushing them and so on. How can this help? So we were very kind of excited to do the following thing. We knew the two dominant paradigms about predicting actions. What should be the right visual input for me to predict actions for my policy network? A lot of literature uses 3D object, low dimensional object states, which is object 3D locations and object 3D poses, right? And fits them into your policy and predicts the actions. Another big literature fit directly the image, the 2D image that try to predict the action. And the truth is that each one of these regimes have the positive and the negatives. So the pros here on the left is that it is data efficient. The input is very short. Okay, it's easier to learn that network. This policy network has fewer parameters, but that network is blind. It cannot see if you change the appearance of the object. I mean, again, you're going to fit the 3D location in pose, but how does the network know if you put a pen or if you put a mug, for example, or you vary the object in some other ways? And here, the image to action mapping that everybody loves because it's end-to-end and differentiable and kind of elegant, I mean, it's extremely data inefficient, despite the fact that if it would work, it would supposedly generalize across objects and scene appearance because it does look at the objects, actually. And by the way, this image can also be a 2.5D image. You can also fit the point cloud, all right? So we did spend a lot of time trying to use our 3D feature maps as input for policy networks and do reinforcement learning and so on. Yeah, that was extremely computationally expensive. I mean, these networks, each forward pass takes time because it builds this 3D feature map and so on. So what we found is the following. We can look at the scene and predict its 3D feature representation, and you can have a cluttered scene, but if you want to manipulate a specific object, it's good to detect that object and only take the surrounding input features. And by the way, these input features don't need to be only the object. You can also take the surrounding clutter, because if an object, for example, is very attached to the wall, you may need to use different control primitive to pick it up as opposed to if it's, you know, standalone on the table. So here is our approach, which is very simple. You take your image or 2D or 2.5D, you infer the 3D feature map, and then you essentially do nearest neighbors. You have a library of behaviors, a library of controllers, and for example, for pushing, you have 25 different ways to push an object. And for each one of those behaviors, controllers, you learn an embedding so that the embedding of the object and the embedding of the behavior, they should be close if that behavior is successful for a particular object. So it looks something like that. So here's the image. And then we extract some features, which we always transform because we allow you to put the camera wherever you want. But if a robot doesn't change, then you better rotate the feature back to the robot's frame. Then you crop the object based on what you have, based on your 3D detector, which we assume that we can detect objects in 3D, even under clutter, all right, with these methods. And then essentially we learn with trial and error. You can initialize these features with your prediction if you like, But to be completely honest, it didn't help. View prediction, initialization did not help. How things look have not much to do with how you're supposed to grasp them or push them. It did help though to train the 3D detector, right? So view prediction as a self-supervised pretend was useful for the 3D detector. And essentially what is trainable in this architecture is these parameters here and those retrieval keys. These are free variables. So that the test time, I look at an object and I the relevant behaviors fire and I just apply the controller. So these are the experiments that we tried. So we looked at grasping and pushing in simulation, and we had different behaviors. So here are behaviors for, so we have two different, so the big question here is actually we discussed about that with also in one of the meetings earlier, that how do you build that library is not that clear. Well, for grasping, we just picked some open loop controllers from different orientations. They were picking up the objects from different orientations. I think the right thing to do is you can use this fantastic 3D proposal methods, and each of these proposals could be such a hypothesis, and then you use these features to select which one to try out. And we saw that you know, the visual grounded library of behaviors actually did much better on pushing. So here's the pushing than other methods. We compared also with DexNet and GrassNet. We fine-tuned DexNet and GrassNet on this data. We were able to successfully fine-tune DexNet, and indeed very well if we would give the ground truth object location, but if we didn't, then it would drop performance more than our method. The other thing is that DexNet has only top-down grass, so it cannot pick up plates that our method can pick up. Yeah, GrassNet, we have some difficulty about when we were varying the initial location of the objects in the scene. The objects here can show up wherever you want on the table. So in any case, what we found is that this 3D selector could be reliable, could be quite reliable in selecting the right controller for the right object. And we tried to do the same selection using 2D features, and we had much worse performance despite even when pre-training from ImageNet features from large supervised datasets. And fine-tuning with trial and error was very important because view prediction, how things look, do not really correlate with how you're supposed to manipulate them. Now, why this is important? Well, at least now we have some reliable way to pick up diverse objects, to push diverse objects, to drag diverse objects around. Of course, grasping has seen fantastic progress, and everybody uses very diverse object sets. Beyond grasping, nobody uses diverse object sets for pushing all the time. We use pushing with the same object, or we very rarely vary the object. Let me just mention that our library of behaviors here for grasping is open loop controllers, but for pushing is closed loop policies that we train with reinforcement learning. Each one was trained with different objects, so then you made the library out of that. All right, and then you see this particular policy, which other objects it can satisfy. You train this with trial and error. Right now, we're looking at imitation learning techniques, some easy imitation learning techniques to instantiate those behavioral libraries.
I have a question. So what would happen if you try it on objects that is like not very similar to the training data? Because basically like something that the nearest neighbor that let's imagine that I want to grasp an unknown object, like a new object, and the features that I get are totally different from all the dictionary of the features that I have seen before.
Let me clarify that. So for example, this dictionary is similar to a softmax classifier. Like a softmax classifier, you take your image, it spits out in 1D embedding, 1D embedding, and eventually this centers into the softmax to give you the logits and so on. So this, by nearest neighbor, I mean that every behavior has a key, has a, you know, embedding, and you as an object, you're supposed to say, oh, I need to spit out an embedding that is closer to that, to the key one, or closer to key two, or closer to key three, and so on. Regarding generalization, these things that I'm showing is on a test set. If the objects are very different, then your performance drops. something that we did not do, which is not very intelligent, is to not use color. Dexter doesn't use color, which makes total sense to pick up objects, at least that they are not that deformable, or there is not some semantic property that the color can give you to figure out how to grasp it. So that would make things generalized better. But by nearest neighbor, I mean just you have a memory of controllers, right? And you learn how to index them so that you can select a different controller per object. You can also imagine that's a softmax over controller. So it's a classifier. So for this object, which controller shall I pick? For this object, which controller shall I pick? But instead of a softmax, we had a contrastive objective. That's it, but which is they're interchangeable.
Okay.
If that thanks. Makes sense.
Yeah, makes sense.
Now, the last part that I want to discuss that I'm actually excited about, we've been working on this for some time now, is how 3D representations are related to language grounding. And why language grounding? Why we care about language grounding? Because we do want to give instructions to robots to do things. For example, place the can to the right of the ball. So that's something extremely simple that we tried to do back in 2018. And we said, we're going to collect human demonstrations with narrations. For example, in this image, the can is to the left of the ball, and here the can is to the right of the ball. All right, so I collect such exemplars from videos of people moving objects around. And then our goal was to train a classifier, to train a visual detector. So instead of using hard-coded rewards for placement policies, we could use the learned reward. So I could look at the environment. I would tell you, place the can, the Coca-Cola can, to the right of the ball. And then I'll be watching you. And I would give you reward when you would succeed to do that task. And that you will use my rewards to train your policy using reinforcement learning, for example. And what happened now with this work? So we started like that. So usually when you want to learn, I know we discussed with Karthik about these representations, when you want to learn referentiable special expressions like this, what people do is they try to localize the objects that are being referred to, and then they build a classifier by looking at the features inside the box and by looking at relative spatial features of the two bounding boxes. And you don't want to look more than spatial features because then you overfit. And then, so here is our reward detector that we managed to train. So the can now is to the right of the book. And then now you're going to take it. It's still fine. It's still high. The score is still high. And now you're going to take it, go back, and the reward is going to drop. And the hope was that you will use this automated reward function to train a policy with RL. And the truth is that our conclusions was that this reward detector actually did not work very well, did not generalize across viewpoints. Not only this, but also the rewards that these binary words, yes, no, this classifier, so this can to the left of the ball being a yes, no classifier, I had a huge difficulty training a policy with this binary word. So the question is, what is the right representation for the Coca-Cola can? If I tell the Coca-Cola can is to the right of the mug, right? Is this a classifier or not? And then we came across this nice paper, Symbol Grounding and Meaning, from Glenberg and Robertson 2000, that they said that people can infer affordability of answers. So one other thing that our detector couldn't figure out is it could not distinguish between possible goals and impossible goals. So if I could tell to the robot, put the mug inside the Coca-Cola can, the robot could not say this doesn't make sense. Okay, so the robot didn't have any common sense using those two declassifiers. The question is, how can we make our robot be aware, our machine be aware, and say, what you're telling me now, it doesn't make sense? Because humans can do that. Humans, you can give them identical, grammatical and syntactically identical sentences, what I'm showing here. After wading barefoot in the lake, Eric used his shirt to dry his feet, or Eric used his glasses to dry his feet. And you very easily say the second thing doesn't make sense, because you know that glasses cannot dry feet. And we want the same thing for the machines. And this is my favorite example. He used the newspaper to protect his face from the wind versus he used the matchbox to protect his face from the wind. If you have an idea of the size of the matchbox and what is the wind and where is the face, then you can understand that the second doesn't make sense. But even simple things like that, like the ball inside the cube or the cube inside the ball, even this we cannot do right now with 2D classifiers. There is this interesting conjecture about simulation semantics that humans understand natural language by simulating the content of the utterance. They use similar cortex to perception and control inside their heads, which means that if you tell me the mug, I bring in my head something that looks like a mug. And if you bring a Coca-Cola again, I bring something like a Coca-Cola. While so far, a vision and language model that just try to associate words with 2D images do not actually have this reasoning capability, because a 2D image does not even have a size information, right? Does not have a size information, does not have a containment information. You just see the front surfaces of the object. You don't know what's a ball, what's not a ball, right? You cannot easily reason from space. You cannot do spatial reasoning. So now we said, let's try to use our 3D feature representations for language meaning. And we wanted to build two types of networks. The first network, you should be able to tell me something, and me, without looking at any image, I should be trying to understand what you're talking about. So you should try to say the ball to the left of the can, and me, I'm going to bring now a ball in my memory, and then I'm going to build a can and pull to the left, right? So this is what we did. So we build those type of generators. So we assume we have scenes annotated with language, and we allow the agents to go around and build 3D feature maps. And then what we learn is imaginations. Imaginations that go from noun phrases, like green rubber cylinder, all the way to 3D feature maps. Okay, like instantiation of the object with the right size and so on. So here's another noun phrase to object centric feature map, as well as here is about spatial expressions, and spatial expressions will be predicted based on 3D relative offsets. Okay, and then you will tell me something, and now I'm going to make the correct imagination. And now that I can imagine things, I can imagine as many things as you like, because each time you tell me something, I have my 3D canvas, I have my 3D imagination space, and I'll try to put things in a way that makes sense. And if you tell me something that doesn't make sense, for example, the pen is to the left of the pencil, and the pencil is to the left of the pen, or, you know, the mask is to the right of the, to the left of the pen and so on, I'll try to make an imagination to realize what you're telling me. And if I, after enough sampling, I cannot get it right, I cannot satisfy the classifiers, everything makes sense, then I'll say, I don't think this is affordable. I don't think this is possible. Okay. So we have some spatial awareness now that we reason between language and the world, as opposed to language and the image. And so, okay, this is kind of a toy data set, but we are working now on full interior homes and so on. So here's your imaginations. You tell me things and I generate videos for you, because I can render now my imaginations into colors. And you may think that they're blurry, but that's why I'm showing here what is called the blender render. If you do nearest neighbors on those features that I generated, you'll retrieve the correct object. If you have, let's say, an object memory, and you use my generation to retrieve the right object from the memory, you'll retrieve the right thing indeed based on the description. Because the imaginations of people are also not pixel accurate. We don't care of generating beautiful images, okay? And then you can put as many objects as you want in the description, and I'll still manage to generate it. So why this is important for robot control? Because now you may tell me, put the blue sphere to the right and behind of the green cube. So you ask me to alter the scene in some way. And me, instead of taking as before in our previous project, where I would take the blue sphere right behind green cube and try to train a binary classifier, what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate an imagination. I'll say, this is what he wants. He's trying to ask me to generate this 3D scene, all right? And by the way, these imaginations are also multimodal because we use stochastic networks. So you can sample diverse placements of where you can put them. But basically now I can hear what you're telling me, and I can generate the scene alteration. And yeah, because I can detect the object that you are referring to, I can imagine the object that you are referring to that is not in the scene and put it in the right place. By the way, the first part, which is object detector here, we have a 3D referenceable object detector that I described. So not only we generate, but also detect. So you need both discriminative models and generation models. And indeed these detectors, because they operate in 3D, are better than 2D. But the important thing is now you tell me put the cube to the right of the ball and so on. And I can just use even LQR. I can use any simple any simple trajectory optimizer, because I have a goal to satisfy. I have a goal scene to satisfy. It's much easier than operating using binary rewards. Okay. And okay, this is kind of simple, but right now we are thinking about, we're working about tables and vases on the table, and or the backpack under the table or on the sofa and so on. It's the same ideas that you need to do.
I have a question. So since you do the 3D detection and you want to reason about this spatial relationship, do we really need to even train a model for finding the spatial relationship? Like I have two boxes, I can just compare the coordinates and say whether it is on the left or on the right.
Yeah, this is our spatial classifier. Is just doing that. He's using 3D offsets and predicts, yes, this to the left, this to the right, this is inside, and so on. Now later things become more complicated, because you may tell me I want a vase on top of the table, and I need to use a previous imagination of what's a vase on top, because I don't want to put the vase tilted, I want to put upright. So it's not just enough to put the object in the right spatial arrangement, but also but this is not, it's not here, but yes, you're absolutely right. Yes.
And is the imagination conditioned on the current observation, or it's just not conditional and it just tries to generate an image just from the text command?
Yeah, great question. So let me clarify that. There is this unconditional imagination. For example, I tell you now, imagine a Coca-Cola can inside a ball, and you generate that in your mind. But if you want your robot to act in your scene, then you're going to say probably to the robot, put the blue sphere to the left of the green cube, and the green cube is already in the scene. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take your utterance and find the noun phrases, which, by the way, in that work we assume the parse tree is given. Now there are semantic parsers that can give that, and then I'm going to detect whatever I can detect and say, yes, I found the green cube. And then for the thing that I cannot detect, I say, okay, let me generate that and put it in the right place. So it's scene alteration. It's a combination between imagination and actual reality. Okay. So in any case, this is, as I said, it's toy world, right? It's clever. But the important thing is that, as Arsalan said, in 3D, it's very reliable to at least spatial relationships. You can be very confident when you detect them and reason about them and so on. And my only, because we're also out of time, I just want to say that you can take these 3D feature representations, detect objects, and make prototypical dictionaries by, you know, quantizing them into rotation and scale invariant, let's say, prototypes. And just to say that the same method we used here for visual question answering, again on Clever, and again with very, very, very little data, because we would take the scene, detect the object, separate style and shape, blue from cube, so that even if I haven't seen the red cube, but I have a red sphere, I can imagine their combination. And yes, there is the shape matching and so on, and color matching, and you have the different dictionaries. I just want to mention that, you know, there is this paper, and if you want to take a look, I'm just trying to advertise it a bit. Yeah, so we have qualitative results and very good, you know, numbers with very, very, very little data, because as you pointed out, yes, for these simple relationships, you don't need that much data, only, of course, for understanding the object and their categories and colors and so on. Also, we have one shot novel objects at the test time and so on. So ongoing work, I just described things that we have been exploring. Of course, to make these things really scale, one thing we've been putting a lot of effort is on dynamic scenes. Objects are moving, you need to track. The hand is manipulating articulated objects. You need to figure out the segmentation, where things go and so on. The library of behaviors, to be useful, you really need to scale it up. As we discussed also in the morning with Tapu. When you want to learn dynamics models, it needs to be general. It needs to be about food. It should not be just rigid objects moving around and so on. And we do want to go from such a closed world of language to an open vocabulary. And this is our, let's say, pursuit. And I want to thank the students that did the work and you for your great attention and your invitation again. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So the results are super impressive. I'm wondering, what do you think it takes so that we get to the level where any robotics lab, they could just, let's say, download a pre-trained network for these kind of tasks, right? And kind of use it in their lab setting, right? Like on the objects that they care about. Because right now, of course, a lot of the work is still leveraging a lot of kind of simulated data sets, right? But if you want to do something that really works across kind of any, let's say, tabletop setting, in any lab in the world, I guess we need to get to the level where the representations are kind of as robust as what we might see sometimes in whatever the OpenAI clip kind of models or something like that.
Yes. So I think what you're saying is I want a model that reliably, let's say, for example, first of all, a segment detects and segments the object. Is this what you mean?
Yeah, and then you can do the reasoning that you just described, but not just in an individual lab experiment, but so that other labs can more or less just, let's say, download the networks and they work for them too.
Yes. So first of all, I'm not sure if this is at all relevant, but all the code, of course, is public. I think what you're saying is what happens beyond cubes and so on, and what happens under clutter. I'm not sure if you saw, but there was not really clutter. There's no laundry basket with objects thrown inside. Okay. In fact, we found that this is a huge makes a huge difference. And in fact, that's why we cannot track manipulation right now so well. We need to, if we want to do visual imitation, we really need to make sure that the human is actually demonstrating things in a very clean way. The object should not be very occluded and so on. But I think modules that are out there, I can say that, for example, you can train generic 2D segmenters from tons and tons of combined data, and they will highlight the object for you. You can train generic 3D object segmenters detectors that again will highlight the objects for you. Those 3D relationships, as your student also pointed out, they're very, very easy classifiers. So if you're in 3D, a lot of things are become much easier, basically. Regarding training this trial and error libraries, this is the only work in progress. It's not even published anywhere, right? But yes, scaling this up and having, okay, here is a grasper and run it and you're going to pick up your objects, or it's going to push your objects, or it's going to pick and place them in the right place. This also, where we really hope to contribute. It's just that this is the most recent work and there's nothing. So we're just developing this already. It's not even published anywhere. I just mentioned it because it's very relevant for the robotics clock.
Thanks a lot. It's very exciting.
I have one question. So how do you plan? So I think at some point you mentioned about like 3D representations are great. Like, but how do you plan to combine that with NLP? Like, can you think about representations where the combinations could be helpful and maybe can help in generalizing for the task that Dieter was talking about?
Like to be able to work out of the box. Is this what you mean?
Right.
Okay, yeah, I see. So we know that the SynGraph, 2D SynGraph works to not actually work out of the box. We know 3D spatial relationships do work out of the box. Object segmentors and detectors to some extent work with some, some added self-supervision and augmentation. This is what we do all the time. Regarding how do we combine language with 3D? So one thing that we realized since we finished these works is the following. Some concepts do not actually need the 3D reasoning. For example, the woman wearing a pink t-shirt, you do not need to reason about this in 3D. The backpack in front of the sofa potentially is more useful. And another thing that I realized is that, let's say I'm a robot and I want to put the backpack in front of the sofa, I can have a 2D goal. I can have a 2D image as a goal. And I try to, as I vary my viewpoint, try to match to the 2D goal configuration. So asking for everything to go in 3D, straight away you need to throw away all those 2D annotated data sets that potentially is not like a great idea. About language grammar, when you say that, I say again, because we discussed earlier with you about spatial relationships, I think spatial relationships are very, very, very doable with, if you have a good 3D object detector segmenter and some annotations from in front, behind, inside, under, and so on and so forth. Do you see what I mean? Now, let me just also make something now that I remembered it. There are very important exceptions, and that's why we go beyond categories right now. Imagine something on a chair. Imagine a teddy bear on a chair. So how would this approach handle this? It would make a 3D bounding box around the chair, a 3D bounding box around the teddy bear, and it would ask the teddy bear to float around the chair, above the chair. Do you understand that one? So this is clearly not how a teddy bear is on top of a chair, correct? So this realization and others like that suggest that you do need to remember your specific experiences. And next time that I tell you my glass is on top of a chair, you should retrieve the teddy bear on top of a chair and adapt it and edit it accordingly, as opposed to having all the way parametric models that I just described. Do you think that makes sense?
Yep. Thank you.
Yeah. So on top of the shelf, on top of the table, on top of a sofa, on top of a chair, these are all on top language-wise, but they have very different instantiations, and 3D bounding boxes are not actually enough to handle. You really need to go inside the box and correspond. And then the difficult visual correspondence problem shows up, but I'm not sure there is a way around that.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.